The Birth of Venus by Botticelli has to be one of the most reinterpreted artworks of all time. It has proven to be translatable across mediums, cultures, and time. From Beyoncé to Gaga to inspiring the first appearance of the novel phenomenon which is the Bond girl. Let's dive into the influence of Botticelli's Birth of Venus in modern and contemporary art. Walter Crane's painting, The Renaissance of Venus, borrows heavily from Botticelli, with a very similar colour palette and posing. Her nudity is this time fully exposed, though Crane's wife had actually insisted he use a male model for the figure of Venus here, at cause of the impropriety of being in a room with a nude female model at the time. In absence of a real referent to work from, this would also perhaps explain the bizarre depiction of her genital region, or lack thereof, which vastly contrasts the very unbald mass of her beautiful strawberry blonde tresses, which coil and spill like the soft lapping of the calm waves on this shore. We can also see the effects of the male model in the Michelangelo-esque musculature of Venus, as well as in the bodies of the women in the back, on the left, presumably the Three Graces, which also harkens back to another painting of Botticelli's, Primavera, which was analysed in another video on this channel. Crane had encountered the Birth of Venus during his honeymoon in Italy. Though beautiful, the saccharine depiction of the goddess of love and beauty by Crane has been little changed since Botticelli's version, apart from perhaps a subtle stylistic Victorian update. This next reinterpretation is quite the opposite of Walter Crane's. I want to introduce a trigger warning here for some graphic discourse on the 18th and 19th century slave trade. This image is intended to depict a black woman travelling over from Angola in Africa to the West Indies, in a journey as part of the transatlantic slave trade, known as the Middle Passage. Psychoanalyst Michael Vannoy Adams notes in his article linked in the description that the image was first published in Brian Edwards' book, The History, Civil and Commercial of the British Colonies in the West Indies, accompanied by a poem which reads, "The loveliest limbs her form compose, such as her sister Venus chose, in Florence where she's seen, both just alike except the white, no difference, no, none at night, the beauteous dames between." The poem and image whitewashed the slave trade, grossly romanticising slavery and the slave experience. The word glamorisation feels like a mass understatement here. This is the epitome of the white race convincing themselves of doing no wrong, as if slavery was a virtuous act. The black female in the centre, the quote-unquote Venus, is surrounded by all white cherubim and gods. The Greek deity Triton waves a British flag, leading her across the water. Adams goes on to say, "The image is not a slave narrative, but a master narrative. It is a projection, a cultural imposition that serves a quite specific purpose for white European men. In this image, which is both racist and sexist, the slave is a woman, and not just any woman, but a woman no man coerces because she always consents. As a woman, the slave never resists." Where Botticelli depicted the epitome of perfect beauty, this image goes further in its idealization. Slave shackles and chains have been swapped out for feathers and shells. There is only one woman here making her voyage, rather than the 600 or so people crammed onto the one ship. The reality is that women and girls were raped by the crew, with an estimated total of over 12 million slaves being transported through the Middle Passage to the Americas. Multiple lives were lost, and the rest of those who survived were harmed for years to come. Into the 20th century, and we can look at Orlon, the French artist who surgically altered her appearance to resemble that of the art history greats, Da Vinci's Mona Lisa and Botticelli's Venus. She taped and broadcasted her plastic surgery live to a New York gallery, the Pompidou, and several other locations in Canada and throughout Europe. The work was a comment on iconoclasm, the destruction of the centering of female beauty. A melange of high and low art took place, as did the everyday with the divine. She was criticised for this work for bringing a sensationalism to the art space. Though you could say this is a matter of opinion, and who's to say that no one had done this before? At the time, Botticelli's Venus herself was perceived as radical, due to the almost never-before-seen level of nudity in such a large-scale painting. In the era of the rising 90s supermodels, Orlon here ridicules the obsession with women's appearances, taking the project to gruesome heights. It is surgical brutality. She even sold off some of her flesh. On to lighter and more comedic iterations of Botticelli's Venus, we can briefly explore Terry Gilliam's reappropriations. I will let Terry explain himself.
Static, elegant, naked, sexy. And there's the girl running with the robe, but the robe wouldn't look so good if the winds weren't blowing, nor would her hair look so beautiful. So now we stick the wind machine in over there on the left-hand side. And it's like, this is a commercial for shampoo.
Seeing the comedy in the painting, we could argue is thanks to the passing of time since it was finished. Gilliam completed a farcical animation of the birth of Venus in Monty Python. It delights in a kind of Victorian string puppet slapstick in true Gilliam style. He also cast Uma Thurman to play Venus, a small but beguiling role in his 1988 comedy adventure film, The Adventures of Baron Munchausen. Both of these depictions effectively dethrone Venus. She becomes just one of Gilliam's absurd characters, routine to his comedy, rather than the unfathomable peak of all things unattainably beautiful. This interpretation by Yin Xin sees Venus once again portrayed as a different race, but this time the artist himself directs the racialized depiction. Yin Xin has refashioned a series of canonical Western paintings, and here we instantly recognize Botticelli's Venus by the perfect symmetry of her face, her flowing hair making curlicues which frame her presence in the space. The blue hue of the sky implies this Venus is equally outdoors, and even her shoulders slope as in Renaissance fashion, which was seen as a trait of beauty in women at the time. This is a severe cropping of Botticelli's composition, however. We focus in on the woman's face, wearing the strongest sign of her difference to the well-known fair-skinned Venus with golden blonde locks. Like sloped shoulders, white skin was another beauty standard of the Renaissance era, arguably both classist as well as racist. It was implied women with fairer skin were those who wore their youth, virginity, and high status, in comparison to those of the lower classes who would have had a darker complexion at cause of exposure to the sun during work, or the blatant racism that rejected those of a darker tone naturally. We look at Yin Xin's Venus with eyes as tender as we do Botticelli's. She is equally as beautiful, but simultaneously we are struck by the subversion of her appearance. We are confronted with Western standards as given, the whiteness around which canonical art history arranges itself, and those who have traditionally been outside of it, to the detriment of the field of study. Very many of these works featured in the excellent exhibition Botticelli Reimagined at London's V&A in 2016. I have left the link to this show in the description of this video. It's absolutely worth having a flick through the impressive collection of works the show displayed. Which was your favourite of this video? How do you feel about artists commenting on a painting so widely disseminated since its creation? Do questions of originality and pushing boundaries and new ideas have a part to play? Or is it important to acknowledge art history's particular Eurocentricity and in turn the erasure of those outside of that cultural identity? These are conversations well worth having, food for copious thought which will continue to be discussed in upcoming videos on this channel. So those of you who have subscribed already, thank you. And those of you who have made it this far to the end of the video and are perhaps viewing this channel for the first time, consider it. It's free and it really helps out the growth of Constellations a lot. Peace and love to all. Thank you wholeheartedly for watching.